Nicely done. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to our worship service. Welcome to those of you who are worshiping with us from home. It's always amazing to me how quickly our time passes in the church calendar. I mean, just last week, we were celebrating Jesus as a baby. He was 8 years old. He was receiving his name. And today we look at the readings and we discover that he's a young man about to embark upon his healing ministry. But before that, of course, he needs to be baptized, at least according to him. And John the Baptist and Jesus have a bit of a conversation about that. But John finally acquiesces to Jesus' requests and decides to baptize him. And so we get to celebrate both of the sacraments of the Lutheran Church this morning. We celebrate baptism and also Holy Communion. So again, a reminder to those people who are watching from home, if you'd like to celebrate Holy Communion with our congregation towards the end of the worship service, now would be a good time to prepare the bread and the wine that you are going to be needing. And also joining us around our table for the first time in spirit this morning is the most recent of our associates, I guess, friends of the church who are in glory. Daryl and Bev are mourning today the death of Bev's father, who passed away very suddenly in the last week. We'll be remembering them in our praise. In the waters of the Jordan, Jesus is revealed as the beloved Son of God. Through this great epiphany, Jesus fulfills all righteousness and becomes the servant of God who will bring forth justice and be a light to the nations. In the waters of baptism, we too are washed by the Word, anointed by the Spirit, and named God's beloved children. Our baptismal mission is to proclaim good news to all who are oppressed or in need of God's healing.
Please rise if you're able for our opening hymn, number 304 in our Cranberry Hymnal, Christ, when for us you were baptized.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Baptism of Jesus, you proclaimed him your beloved Son and anointed him with the Holy Spirit. Make all who are baptized into Christ faithful to their calling to be your daughters and sons, and empower us all with your Spirit through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 42,
Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry or lift up his voice or make it heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not grow faint or be crushed until he has established justice in the earth. And the coastlands wait for his teaching. Thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people upon it and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I have taken you by the hand and kept you. I have given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon, from the prison, those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord. That is my name. My glory I give to no other, nor my praise to idols. See, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. The psalm is Psalm 29, and we'll read it responsibly. Ascribe to the Lord, you gods, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is upon the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar trees. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. The voice of the Lord bursts forth in lightning flashes. The voice of the Lord makes the oak trees writhe and strips the forest bare. And in the temple of the Lord, all are crying, glory. O Lord, give strength to your people. Give them, O Lord, the blessings of peace. The second reading is from Acts chapter 10. Peter began to speak to Cornelius and his household. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did in Judea and Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear. Not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Please rise if you are able for our gospel acclamation.
Amen.
Gospel according to St. Matthew, the third chapter. Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness." Then he consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." This is the Gospel of the Lord. I invite you to be seated, and I'd like to ask the children if they would come forward for a little bit of a time with them. Hi, Sarah. Hi, Princess. Did you know that's what your name is? Yeah, I think we did that last week. What people's names are. So I looked up all the names at all. You snuck up on me. Hey, it's good to see you guys again. You weren't here last week. Because you forgot. I'm going to guess you didn't come because you forgot. You were sick? Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. You feel better now? Okay, that's good. Four. Three. So the reason that I was wondering, today I wanted to talk to you about remembering. How do you, are there any things that you need to remember every day? Are there any things that you need to remember every day? What? God talked to you while you were sleeping? Cool. That is very amazing. What about... Okay. You can remember that. Oh, good, because not all dreams are things that you can remember, right? You can't remember all your dreams. Sarah, is there something that you need to remember every day? Turn the lights off. Hang on a second. Pardon? Lunch? You remember your lunch? I have to remind myself to remember my lunch, which, of course, is the most important thing that I take to work with me every single day, right? And so do you have a trick to remember your lunch? You bring it, your mom and dad. I heard Sylvain say your mom and dad. You know what I do? I put my briefcase close to the door because I make my lunch the day before because I'm too, you know, I want to sleep as long as I can the next day. And then I take my drink. It doesn't need to be refrigerated. I put it on my briefcase. And then before I'm going out the door, I look at it and I say, "Oh, I have to remember my lunch because lunch and drink go together." So then I go to the fridge and I get my lunch. Because that bottle is, or that can, or that drink is reminding me, go to the fridge and get your lunch. So we always leave ourselves all kinds of messages about things that we want to remember. And one of the messages, or I should say one of the ways in which the Jewish people reminded themselves of the most important thing in the world, and that is God's word, is they would put... Are we playing a game? I can see you up there, you know. I can see you up there. You see the TV? I know where you are. So one of the ways in which the Jewish people reminded themselves of God's word was they put little boxes and they tied them to their foreheads and they tied some of them to their left arm because that's close to their heart. And the scripture said, keep God's word close to your mind and close to your heart. And I asked Stephen if he would find a picture of something called a phylactery. You see that little box that Orthodox Jewish person is wearing on his forehead? That's called a phylactery, and that was what they used to remind themselves of God's word. So they would put little scrolls inside there with God's word on it. And every time they looked in a mirror, or every time they looked at another person who was also Jewish, they would see a phylactery. And then they would be reminded of God's words to them, that they were God's people. Now, we also have reminders on our foreheads that remind us that we are God's children and that God loves us. Can I show you? Come back here. I want to show you where it is. You can't see it, but it's right here. It's right here. So we turn around so everybody can. You have one of these. It's right here. You know what that is? It's a cross. It's the sign of your baptism. And when you are baptized, doesn't matter what age, most of you probably as a little tiny itty-bitty baby, the pastor put a cross on your forehead. And that was to say to you and to everybody that this is my child that I love. I am well pleased with you. That's what God says about us. Do you think that's an important thing to remember? Every day, every minute, it really is. What a difference it makes in our lives if we can remember that we are God's special gifts and that He loves us. There's nothing more to be said about that. Let's fold our hands and bow our heads and repeat after me. Dear God, we thank you for the special relationship that we have with you. We are your children, loved and blessed by you. Help us to remember that every minute of every day. Grace to you and peace. I'll give the kids another minute. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, through your Holy Spirit, open our ears to hear you, our hearts to feel you, our eyes to see your epiphany, that we might be blessed. Amen. One of the decisions that every good storyteller needs to make is when to tell the story's secret to people. Every story has a secret. And the weaver of tales has to decide whether to let the people in on the secret early in the story or to surprise them with it in the end. Mystery writers, we know, will often hold back the secret until the last chapter, keeping us eagerly turning the pages to discover who really poisoned the heiress, or who was it that pushed Colonel Whittington down the elevator shaft. And the same is true, or was true, of soap operas. Will Martha find true happiness with Jason the chauffeur? Well, tune in tomorrow for another episode of The Old and the Listless. In other words, turn the page, tune in tomorrow, and the secret will be revealed to you. There are other stories, however, in which the storyteller reveals the secret at the beginning. We know the secret even before some of the characters do, and we watch them gradually discover the hidden truth that we already possess. Oh, Grandma, what big teeth you have, sings the innocent little Red Riding Hood, but we already know, don't we, the secret of what ravenous destruction lies bonnet clad underneath those covers. Or in an Aesop's fable, The Tortoise and the Hare, because of Aesop's reputation for telling stories with a twist, we're pretty sure how that one is all going to turn out in the end. There's a legendary tale about the eminent scientist Albert Einstein walking in front of a local hotel and being mistaken for a bellboy by a rich young lady who had just arrived in a luxury sedan. And so she ordered Einstein to carry her luggage into the hotel. And according to the story, Einstein did that. And he received a small tip. And then he continued on to his office to ponder the mysteries of the universe. True or not, the story, I think it's delightful because we know from the beginning a secret that the rich young woman does not know. The strange-looking, ruffled little man is the most celebrated intellect of his time. So see, some stories gain their power from knowing the story's secret from the start. That's the kind of a story that St. Matthew's Gospel is. The secret of St. Matthew's Gospel is the identity of Jesus Christ. And yet, in the very first sentence of the Gospel, Matthew lifts the veil and lets us know the secret when he says that this, Gospel according to Matthew, is the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the Christ. See, that's the secret. And just in case we miss it, this hidden truth is confirmed when Jesus, coming out of the waters of baptism, sees the Holy Spirit descending upon him, coming like a dove from the heavens, which have been torn open like a piece of cloth, and he hears the very voice of God telling him the secret. This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. God knows the secret, Jesus knows the secret, and because Matthew has let us in on it, we know the secret too. Jesus is the Son of God. And now we watch with amazement as the story unfolds because almost nobody else seems to be able to discover the secret. The authorities mistake him for a troublemaker. The people confuse him with John the Baptist come back to life, or with Elijah, or one of the prophets. And even his disciples are blind to the full truth of who he is. The thing is, he doesn't look like the Son of God. Like the genius Einstein, dragging the heavy suitcases of a wealthy woman up the steps of a hotel, Jesus does not look like who he truly is. And that's part of the reason that the secret remains hidden. Why doesn't Jesus look like the Son of God? Well, because he suffers. And that seems unlikely in God's own Son. Jesus is the suffering Son of God. And that is a hard secret to learn. Once the disciples came very near to discovering the secret, "Who do you say that I am?" Jesus asked them. And Peter, always the bold one, stepped forward with the answer, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And so does Peter know the secret? Well, not really, because then Jesus begins to tell them about what that means. Jesus tells them the whole secret of who he is, that he faces suffering and rejection and death. And Peter, you remember, rebukes him for that. "God forbid it, Lord," he says. "This must never happen to you." And so Peter does not really understand the whole secret. Jesus is the suffering Son of God. And that's a hard secret. That is why Matthew tells us the secret at the beginning. He wants us to know that Jesus is the Son of God when all hell breaks loose on Golgotha. No reasonable person who takes one look at this pitiable Galilean dragging the luggage of the world's sins up the steps of Calvary would say, this is the Son of God. But Matthew wants us to remember that secret that we heard at the beginning of the story. When the most devout people of his day call him a blasphemer and plot his death, Matthew wants us to remember the secret that he revealed. When the Roman soldiers turn his trial into a terrible joke, dressing him in a purple blanket and a crown of thorns, holding their sides with laughter as they kneel before him in mock respect, Matthew wants us to remember the secret of who Jesus really is. And when they drive the spikes into his flesh and when they taunt him to come down from the cross, Matthew wants us to remember the secret that no one else was able to discover. And even there at the end, with the sky completely dark and the air filled with Jesus' cry and the temple curtain torn in two, Matthew wants us to remember that earlier day when the skies, like the temple curtain, were also torn in two and a voice spoke from heaven saying, this is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased. And Matthew wants us to hear also the centurion at the foot of the cross, finally confessing the secret that we knew from the beginning. Truly, the centurion says, this was the Son of God. Appearance and reality. That's the riddle in Matthew's secret. The one who appeared to be rejected is in reality the one in whom God is well pleased. The one who appeared to be deserted by all is in reality the beloved Son. The one who appeared impotent in the face of death is the one in whose power we all live. That's the secret revealed in the baptism of Jesus, and it is the secret in which all Christians share through their own baptism. There's a story by Flannery O'Connor, one of the marvelous Christian writers of our day, called The River, in which a woman named Mrs. Conan, who has been employed for the day to take care of the son of some wealthy and uncaring parents, takes the boy to a riverside baptismal service being led by a preacher named Bevel Summers. Standing on the riverbank, they hear Summers warning the crowd that if they have come for an easy miracle to leave their pain in the river, they have come for the wrong reasons. There ain't but one river, and that's the river of life made out of Jesus' blood, he says. It's a river of pain itself to be washed away. Slow, you people, slow. Suddenly, Mrs. Conan lifts the boy up in the air and asks the preacher to pray for the boy's mother, who has been ill. And Mrs. Conan tells Summers, after a bit more conversation, that she suspects that the boy has never been back. Summers commands her to have the boy. And Summers asks the boy if he wants to be baptized, and when the boy says yes, Summers responds, you won't be the same again. You'll count. Appearance and reality. In the baptism of Jesus, the secret of his identity is revealed, and nothing that appears after that, not even the nails of Golgotha, can take that reality away. You are a child of God. In our baptism, that secret of our identity is revealed. And realizing that, you can't stay the same. And nothing that appears thereafter can take that reality away. For in Jesus Christ, writes Paul in Galatians, you are all children of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ Jesus, have put on Christ. So for us, baptism, you see, answers the question, what am I worth? At the beginning of our lives, we don't have to wait until the end of our stories to find out the answer. For many people, life unfolds day after day with the question unanswered, the verdict in suspense. Have I worked enough? Have I loved enough? Have I been fair enough? Have I been courageous enough? Have I been generous enough? What am I worth? The secret remains hidden to the end. The truth never really known. You know, Blaise Pascal, the French existentialist philosopher, once mused in his book called Pensées, when I consider the briefness of my life, swallowed up before and behind it, the small space I fill, or even see engulfed in the infinite immensity of spaces which I know not and which know not me, I am afraid. Who has set? By whose order and arrangement have this place and time been allotted to me? For many, the secret remains concealed. Who am I? Why am I here? What am I worth? I am afraid. Just a couple more movies. Another one of my very favorite movies, Big Fish. There's a character, the main character, Edward Blue, and he's played by Albert Finney. He's always known how he would die. And as he is lying in his bed just before the last chapter of his life draws to a close, he is recounting many of his most fabulous adventures for the benefit of his son. And every time he comes to a point in his story in which it is not all that certain that he will come out of it unscathed, he reminds himself, wait a minute, this isn't how I'm supposed to die. This isn't how my story ends. This isn't how it happens. And because he knows that he's not at the end, he sets his course of action and engages the moments of his life without fear. In baptism, our secret is out at the beginning. The truth is known at our inception, and there is no need to fear whatever may come. You are my beloved child, God says, my very own. I have placed you here, and I call you my delight. In his autobiographical book, Creative Dislocation, Robert McCaffey Brown remembered that day in 1960 when he participated in a Lutheran worship service in East Berlin, only a short time before the Berlin Wall went up. There weren't very many people present because church attendance was viewed with suspicion by the state, and the East German Republic had developed secular alternatives to replace all of the rituals of the church. And yet, nevertheless, there was a young couple there in the service presenting their child for baptism. And Brown was amazed. He wondered why in the world would they jeopardize their future and the future of their child by insisting on this ancient ritual of baptism when a secular alternative was readily available and painless as well. No repercussions from the state. And then the Reverend Brown wrote, the couple does not have to answer. Their very act of bringing their baby to the church is a public statement of their priorities. They engage in sufficient risk because of their faith. In the face of their quiet public courage, I feel unworthy. This couple knew a secret about their child which no secular tyranny could take away. This is a child of God. The secret of the story is let out at the beginning. And nothing in all creation, neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, can change the story. This little one is a child of God, baptized in the very name of the one whose secret we have always known, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And therefore may the peace which passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Please rise if you are able for hymn number 451, We Are Baptized in Jesus, our hymn of the day. We are baptized in Christ Jesus, we are baptized in his death, that as Christ is raised victorious, we might live a brand new life. And if we have been united in a dreadful death like his, we will all be reunited, for he lives. In the water and the witness, in the breaking of the bread, in the waiting arms of Jesus, who has risen from the dead. God has made a new beginning from the ashes of our past. In the losing and the winning we hold fast. Glory be to God the Father, glory be to Christ the Son, glory to the Holy Spirit, ever three and ever one. And it was in the beginning, glory now resounds again, in a song that has no ending. We will continue with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for our prayers of the people. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Gracious Lord, we thank you for having chosen us as your people. We thank you for all the grace and the privilege that is ours, simply because we were baptized into your family. Help us as individuals and as a community to also be aware of the responsibilities of our relationship with you brings to us. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for your whole church, to whom you have entrusted the gifts of the gospel in your holy sacraments. Keep her ever faithful in her proclamation and diligent in her serving. Rise up pastors and leaders who are responsive to the guidance of your Holy Spirit and sensitive to the cries of your people. Lord, in your mercy. In the baptism of Jesus, we are reminded of our baptism, by which you saved us and granted us a washing of regeneration and renewal in the Holy Spirit. As we see ourselves emerging from the grave with Christ, help us also to see how we must move into the world as servants, doing good, proclaiming the gospel, and bringing forth justice and righteousness. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty and merciful God,
Guide us in our daily works, and make of us all a blessing to others. Especially do we pray today for our brothers and sisters through baptism, Tara and Al and Joe. Grant that as your baptized servants, we may have discernment as to right and wrong, good and evil, always rejoicing in the counsel of your Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful God, help those who are ill, those who are alone, those who are in prison, those endangered in any kind of warfare, those who sit in any kind of darkness, whether baptized or not, to trust in the gentle gift of your presence and companionship. Especially do we pray for Daniel, Nancy, Joe, Evelyn, Brenda, Jeanette, Diane, Sheldon, Carol, Margaret, Al, and Tara, Stephen, Shane, Rolly, Lynn, Marie, Inger, Mandy, Ruth, Lori, myself, Philip, Traches, Marie, Peggy, Helen and Elkanah, Vic, Stephen, Peggy, Helen, and Elkanah again, Vic, Stephen, Nancy, Bruce, Evelyn and Harrison, Vivian and Philip, Shelley, Irene, and Leanne. Help everyone to see the victory that you have won for them and for all of us, through Jesus our brother and our Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Never-ending God, amid all the turmoil and changes of the world, your love is steadfast and your strength never fails. In this time of trouble for St. Joseph's Lutheran Church, Armina Parish, be a sure guardian and a rock of defense. Guide Pastor Harmon and the leaders of the congregation with your wisdom. Comfort those in distress and grant them courage and hope to face the future. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal God, your love is stronger than death and your community is more powerful than the grave. We rejoice in the life of Harold, who you have drawn into your eternal embrace. Bless his wife, Jeanette, and children, Bev and Daryl, and all those who were touched by Harold's life with the peace that comes from knowing your relentless love for all your people. Keep them in communion with Harold until they are reunited with him in ceaseless praise of you around your heavenly home. Lord, in your mercy. Enable the gospel light to shine to the most distant communities of our world and to the most secret recesses of our own lives, that none may be excluded from the redeeming power of your presence. Lord, in your mercy. In the nurturing waters of baptism, you have given us a name as your own and bestowed upon us the gift of your Holy Spirit. Enlighten the hearts of all your people, that we may be faithful in our calling to be your children. Strengthen us through lives of prayer and the study of your word, that we may be fashioned and formed in your likeness. Lord, in your mercy. All these things, and whatever else you see that we need, we ask you to give us. In the name of him who lived and died for us, and who rose again to make our victory complete, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Peace of the Lord be with you always. Please share that peace among you. You may stand, you may sit, whatever you are comfortable with. Please be seated as we continue with our offering. brim our cup of blessing. Gather a harvest from the seeds that were sown, that we may be fed with the bread of life. Gather the hopes and the dreams. Let us pray. Merciful God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Before our closing hymn, are there any announcements? Oh, I see John is coming forward.
Good morning, everybody. Most of you already know that we're postponing the congregational meeting on the 22nd, and it's because we need to do proper paperwork, and it's just taking more time than we had thought. So we'll give you enough notice of when the next one is, as soon as we get our paperwork done. Just some housekeeping things. On this bulletin board here, and the one in the kitchen, there's a concert announcement. And in the kitchen with the poster are some tickets. So if you're interested in going to a concert, and I forget where it's at, but anyhow, check out that poster. Calendars and egg cartons and stamps we keep collecting. So I'll probably be taking the egg cartons and the calendars to the reuse center and the food bank at the end of the month. So keep bringing, and I'll just take them when we have enough to go. By the kitchen, there's a sign-up sheet, so if you'd like to be a lesson reader, an usher, or a counter, please sign up. I mean, I sort of know who can do that job or would like to do that job, but if you would like to be involved, please let me know, and please sign up then by the kitchen. Donation envelopes for 2023 were in mailboxes, and if you'd like one, and we didn't put one in your mailbox, please let us know. And then the income tax receipts actually were mailed on Wednesday. And some of you apparently already have them, so that's good news. But if you don't get yours, I would say in a week or two, then let me know. Or Irma Trache at the back, because she's our financial secretary. And if there's any errors with your receipt also, please let us know and we can go back through our records and check what that is. Thank you.
As many of you know, our church has been involved with the Inner City Pastoral Minister for many, many years. And again, we will be having the lunch next Sunday. And I've been started to gather the things that we need. They love food, but in the past, you know, we used to make sandwiches. Well, that's not good with the COVID. So now everything has to be prepackaged. And so we will be making these packages up on this coming Saturday at 4 o'clock, as soon as the other church is gone. And so if anybody wishes to help, that would be great. And also keep in mind all the people in the inner city in your prayers. It's not even easy to be homeless or in the cold during this time of the year. So keep them in your mind and hearts. Anyway, I just wanted to remind you that the type of things that we give in this lunch are one banana, one orange, a bottle of water, one juice box, one factory-wrapped muffin or protein bar, not a granola bar, a packet of peanut butter or crackers or cheese, one or the other, one cheese string or individually wrapped piece of cheese, and one small bag of chips. It's not a lot for a meal, but it is our presence in the inner city. So thank you for supporting the inner city program. There's 65 churches and plus individuals who support the program, less than it has in the past. So the economics is hitting many groups. So thank you.
Good morning. Just want to share a story that Pastor Mike shared with a group of us yesterday morning. He happened to be available for our men's breakfast, so he came. And we talked about the terrible tragedy that happened New Year's Day to his church. And, of course, he was sharing how people were absolutely devastated, but how overwhelmed they were with the support, the phone calls and outreach, the offers for worship supplies. They're not sure exactly what they're going to be doing right now, but just overwhelmed by the show of support by their synod family, of which we are. And then it was announced that the police are investigating this as a deliberately set fire, so arson. And of course, that turned to anger and frustration and why, and where is God in all of this? And then Pastor Mike shared that one of the ladies who lives very, very close to the church went out into her yard, and it's covered in debris from the fire that had been carried by the wind. And as she was walking through her yard, she saw a piece of paper, and so she bent down to pick it up, and it was the remnants of the Lord's Prayer from their LBW. It had been completely burned around the outside, except for the very bottom. The last part of the prayer was gone, but it ended, "Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us." And that was a very, very powerful message of God's love and grace, that in the midst of this tragedy, there can be healing, there can be forgiveness. And so Mike just wanted to share that story with us, that in the midst of this, they know that God is with them. So continue to keep them in your prayers for Pastor Mike, their council, their parish, and for the Synod family as we work together to try and help them deal with this. So thank you.
Please rise if you're able for our sending hymn number 302 in the Cranberry Hymnal, "As with Gladness Men of Old."
As with joy they hailed its light, lead
Remember the poor.